said good day, sir!
Welcome back, everybody, here to our last game of the night. It's the second game in the series of Mousesports going up against RoXKIS, Russia versus Germany, to see if Mousesports can stay in the number one position in the group, and if RoXKIS can give them something to think about and also secure their position somewhere in the middle section of the group. Of course, only top three managed to get through the group stage, and there's five teams competing up in every single group for the defense. Find the details over at the-defense.com. We want to see the wonderful logo from EIZO as well, where they put in the $25,000 prize money up for grabs. Of course, every team wants to get in for this one. It's the defense. It was the first. It was the biggest tournament in the Dota 2 online world. And, well, it's here to stay, guys. It's here to stay. And let's get ourselves into the game. This is the one to see Mousesports, RoXKIS. And we go in as Mousesports already started off with a hero which I was talking about during the last game with the draft. They love their lone druid. They absolutely love their lone druid. They banned it in the last game and they're going to pick it up in this one. We see Quote for taking on the long lane. We see Black. He also loves, in fact, Lone Druid is one of his signature heroes on the safe lane. And there's just so much you can do with it. And Syndra, again, I love this with his drafts. I really love this with his drafts. He always goes something which is difficult to predict or at least difficult to counter. Like, you want to go with an SD and he picks up a Keeper of the Light. Right now, if he wants to, he could be doing multiple things. We could be looking at a safe lane Keeper of the Light with a PL, SD supporting, and they just take out towers. We could be looking at aggressive lane with the SD Coddle, looking to kill off anything they possibly want to, and that'll be great. You get a lone druid that can take a long lane. We're going to the next set. The Nyx Assassin is actually going to be banned out right now. We've got the possibility of taking out the Bane as well, in case they are a little bit more worried about the Enfeeble on the bear, but probably less than likely they'll ban out the Bane. There's other things which can cause them more issues right now. They might just take out all the hard carries, but BZZ, he's almost got to precautionarily ban out the PL. They can deal with it because they'll still have the Empower from the Magnus, and they've proved that in the past. If they really want to, they can just pick up a Luna as well, and that'll be enough to deal with the PL. The question is, though, will it also be enough to deal with the lone druid? Luna's normal, like, raw DPS will be enough. There goes the PL. BZZ's not taking any risk with it whatsoever. Weaver's going to be banned out by Syndra. Very focused banning against RoXKIS's, like, signature-style heroes. Like Wisp, everyone takes him out. But Gyro, great hero of BZZ. Nyx Assassin caused a lot of problems in the last game. Weaver and now the Darkseer. Dread, of course, marked as one of the best Darkseers in the CIS region. And then you see the bans out from RoXKIS. Take out the PL, precautionary. Take out the Prophet. Quovis had a great time with that one. And that's a pretty stable ban out too. But I got a funny feeling that Quovis going to get himself a slightly more aggressive hero on this top lane. You see the Darkseer being banned out and the Weaver being banned out. Both those heroes could cause a lot of problems for Lone Druid on the bottom lane. And that's what makes me think that Clockwork's already up here for RoXKIS. But RoXKIS are very well known for running the Clockwork just as a supporter. Remaining. There's no direct counter right now the Clockwork will be looking for. Like, he wants to go against Lone Druid and he puts the cogs up. Lone Druid doesn't give a crap about mana. A long lane Clockwork would be perfect for a Lone Druid. Lone Druid will completely and utterly lock out the Clockwork from the lane, pick up a nice early Orb of Venom, maybe some Phase Brutes, and then just destroy Clockwork bit by bit by bit. So RoXKIS, they have to. They're almost forced to run this Clockwork as a support. They're forced to do it. If Mousesports very clearly show they're going to run an aggressive tri-lane on top lane. And I'm interested to see what Mousesports is going to do with this one. What I kind of would like to see them do is something a little bit more old school for them, is running a Windrunner. Running a Windrunner for Quotefa. He's a fantastic Windrunner player. And combining it with a Coddle as well as the SD on the top lane. It's a lot of nukish, but they've already got their strength on the Lone Druid. But they can eat through the life points of anybody on this top lane. Fader gets his puck, so he has nice rotation. There's a lot of magical damage coming off from just the Coddle as well as the puck when you look at those two guys together. And then you got Lone Druid for the physical brunt, like brute force of the bear. And BZZ, the final hero now for the final hero for Mousesports will be coming up soon. But BZZ needs either another support. His mid solo will still be Mag versus Puck. There's gonna be no doubt about that one. They'll still have that matchup. Solo's gonna have a rough time there, but If he's able to get a couple of good hits off on the puck before Fader is able to phase shift, then maybe he'll be able to get a little bit more control in that lane. It'll just become a CS battle for him and ensuring he doesn't die. And when the time does come, he'll make it with the puck RP if he can get the timing right for that one too. Also, not an easy thing to achieve. Lushrak. Secondary support now for RoXKIS. Still finds normal synergy with the Rubik. Good team fight as well. Once you get Mag RP, you get the follow-up Lushrak stun. And then you also got the pulsing and the edict damage, which should help to get through the life points of all the Mousesports people. But the bear won't really care about this. The ones who'll be more concerned is the Puck, the Esty, and the Coddle. They are still rather squishy. But the best defense is offense, Sindarin. I'm kind of having a bit of a long shot to think he'd actually go the Windrunner. But with a Lushrak and Rubik, he's possibly thinking right now, does he still want to go on this top lane? He's got to be thinking about the hero for RoXKIS, and I still feel it's going to be a Luna. They need something to go through that lone druid's life points, and they need something that's going to also win him the lane. The kind of harassment from Luna could be what they're looking for. The problem with both Lushrak as well as Rubik is they both can't escape easily, and... Boom! Block pick! It's a block pick. It's most definitely a block pick. DZZ will not get it. Syndrome will get it. And the beauty of this is, too, because they're both ranged heroes, both Coddle and SD, they both get the buff up from Luna. They're going to have themselves a great old time up on this top lane. They are going to destroy any kind of support that comes in close just from right-click harassment. Like melee heroes, like they try and reach. It's, yeah. 5 seconds. But with both Coddle and SD, the setup is nice. So SD Disruption is the Keeper of the Light Blast, and then Luna with a Lucent Beam, and Alchemist will be the pickup. It's a dangerous hero to try and attempt this with, and I'm wondering, too, if RoXKIS is going to try and call the bluff of Mousesports. Because Black is on that Luna, and this is now where it changes for me. This is where it changes. Unless he swaps heroes, it's going to be a safe lane Luna. It could still be Coddle and SD on the top lane, but yeah, it looks to be just like a push to the bottom lane. But with the Alchemist, it changes everything, though. It really changes everything, because Luna, she's good at pushing. The counter push of RoXKIS is meh. But, I don't think Mousesports want to enter into a farm battle with an Alchemist. Nobody does these days. You have to actively stop the Alchemist from farming. If you don't stop him from farming, you then have to push in through the bottom lane. But you've got to control the Alchemist's jungle. If you don't do so, it'll just be stack after stack after stack, and they will just send Alchemist in there with some nice toxic spray, and you'll get bonus Grievel's Greek Gold from all these creeps. Be him small, be him big, he'll take the money anyway. That's why he loves them, doesn't matter what they are. He doesn't discriminate when he kills in the jungle. So we're going to get ourselves in again, like another pause at the very, very start of a game so players can get their bearings. Mousesports will be ready to go in a moment. Was it Mousesports that actually paused? It was RoXKIS. RoXKIS, they're going to work it out. Wondering if we're going to see any kind of switches here. I still thought the Black would take it up. Koiva can take the solo lane bottom. Like, I'm putting a lot of stock in Black playing lone druid safe lane bottom. But Koiva, that would also be his normal role. That'd also be his normal role to take the solo lane. Doesn't have to always be long lane, it's just the solo lane. So Black could still go with the rest of Mousesports and run that top lane up against the Alchemist. I still think it's strong enough to do it. They will have enough aggression there. And Rubik, Lushrak, and Alchemist, they're actually a pretty dangerous lane. Alright, so they want to remake. So, so Black's going to DC himself out from this one. So we do actually have the full Mousesports lineup that's now arrived. So RoXKIS are using a stand-in for this game. I actually asked who that was, so hopefully I'll get you some information shortly. So we'll just jump ourselves quickly out of this one and get ourselves into a new lobby. So Mousesports, they do actually have their full roster again, which is good. They'll enjoy having their normal support hero back, support player back again. Obviously, being without him is a horrible, horrible thing. As we see if our tournament admins are ready. Yeah. Okay, So I have been told, by the way, the other guy is, the guy called N is, in fact, no name guy. He's just a friend of BZZ. So that guy standing in for RoXKIS is, in fact, just a friend. Not competing in the tournament. Obviously, you cannot use a stand-in, which is playing in any of the teams which are playing in the defense. So Cunning has remade for us. So we'll have another very, very quick start. And we'll see if he goes AP mode. Even if he doesn't, I'm still going to say it. just so we don't have to go through the entire captain's mode. There we go. Now it's changed. Wonderfully done. Wonderfully done. So yeah. Having Fader in here, Mousesports can feel a lot more secure about themselves right now. They know that if they win this game, they sit very, very snug, sitting 5-1 coming in the group stage. And they've only got one more game to play. 5-1, give you 6 points. That's only 3 games. Yep. So they got one more game to play. I did actually have a schedule for this little thing over on my side. We'll have to find it again somewhere. See what's been displayed. Yeah, they're gonna play up against Empire. So they play up against Empire on Monday. The Na'Vi versus RoXKIS game will be the last one. Not the last one of the group because they're still Fnatic to play, but the last one of Group A, which is where this match is coming from. And that could really decide the placing. With RoXKIS' position, it's a dangerous world for RoXKIS right now. Because they go down to 3. Kieta Gaming, they've got a lot of pressure on them. They had themselves a great start. They went 2-0. And they were like, hell yeah. It was like the best game of our lives. That's what it was. But yeah. At the end of the day, you got to keep winning and then stay on top of your group if you want to get through. All right, so let's go. AP mode, we're into our game. Time to get the party started, peoples. Time to get the party started. We're going to kick ourselves off. So everyone's in. Still going to wait for the countdown. There is actually a way to get past this. For people who don't know and you've never done this before, if you hit Alt-Enter... when you're here and you've already picked up your hero and the countdown is still going, hitting Alt-Enter will bypass the countdown for you. And if everyone's hit it, then it'll bypass the countdown for everybody because everyone says they're good to go. Alt-Enter is like the ready-up function inside of Dota 2. But let's get ourselves into this one. Has anyone changed roles? Nope. Everyone still seems to be exactly on the same heroes. And there we go. Jump ourselves inside the game. So we'll be black on that Luna. Now let's see where they go. Where do they go? Cinder and... oh, he's doing it. He's going bottom. We're looking at farming and pushing a bottom lane. They're actually going to go into a battle of farm with RoXKIS. They don't want to go up against the possibility of the triple control lane of RoXKIS. At the same time, though, RoXKIS, they're going to make him do it. They're coming down the bottom lane. Look at the consumables up here on up on BZZ. If there was a ring of Basilius right now, I'd probably say he's looking at Roshan, but... he's not. Vance goes down here. What a very pretty outfit. Like it's like Rubik on weed coming out from the side. It's crazy. But Dredd's actually here on the bottom lane. So no, Alchemist is most definitely going to be farming up on the top lane. So he'll be joined by the stand-in N. He's a no-name player coming out from Russia. BZZ. Yeah, it's already going to be up here for the top lane farm, which puts Solo in the middle lane as the Magnus. So it will be a dual lane on the bottom coming out from RoXKIS. They've done this before with the Clockwork. And they babysit him with a slightly unconventional hero, like we've seen him being babysit with Darkseer, with Vayneskor. Even with the Cog, he can pick people up, lift them out, pass. It's just for the rune control. First rune comes down, and it's a haste rune. So at least Cogs for Dread, it's semi worth it. It at least stops it going up on one of the supports that could make action happen. But with the movement that's coming out from Mousesports, they're making it so that camp can't be blocked. Which means there will be pulls on the bottom lane, which means Dredd's going to have a real tough time down here. And he's not going to get fast levels because it's a dual lane. So it's really slowing him down. Better creep control here from Solo, even though he just missed that last hit. Don't worry, Solo. I was watching. But right now, he's trying to get that line for the Shockwave. Nope, Faders doesn't want to give him anything. Doesn't want to give him anything. Three out of four, he misses every single one. Okay, Solo, I was watching that. I was watching that pretty damn closely. And now it's his turn to try and deny off. I kind of want to keep the camera on him so he's got a chance to redeem himself. The puck is already 2-for-2. And he is still 0-for-1. Throws a shockwave and he gets 1-for-1. Yeah. There you go, 2. Tick him over slowly. Koifa. Actually, for some reason with his bear, he didn't go for the pull. I don't know if this is Miss Micro or something. Looks like the chat was right. But that was from game number one. Why is he dead there? Why is he dead there? It makes no sense for him to die there. Thank you very much, Ryan. Thank you very much, Ryan. Comes at a beautiful time. But it makes no sense why you would die here. You're going up against a Clockwork and a Rubik who has telekinesis level 1. There's not even burst damage here. The burst damage comes from a rocket, which I'm pretty sure he got after the kill happened. He would have had to be tanking up the creep wave and sacrifice his own life to die. It makes no sense that you would die in that position. And now pass. Oh, add insult to injury. Cuts through the tree line. And he has to take a whole lot of damage from the ogres. Now, welcome back, Pass. We remade so you can come and join the game and feed first blood in the world of Blade. Sorry, dude. Sorry. How's that mid lane looking? 14-3 up against 9-for-2. Up on the top lane, Quaid for up against BZZ. But BZZ, he's running Quelling Blade. He realized that if Lone Druid's coming up on the top lane, he can cop a lot of harassment damage. Bear's going to come in at the right time. It stops the pull through. Really smartly done. It means that double creep wave's now going to push in from through the top lane. But Latrak, he's going to go for a secondary pull. But that's why Koifa is also here. Keeps with the aggro and gets a nice Latrak stun off right now and goes into Edict form. Concoction is starting to channel. BZZ is not close enough. He'll end up stunning himself. Couldn't get close enough to anybody. Now the double creep wave, because he was spending most of his time trying to look for the extra stun, he didn't get enough of these denies off. So it's still going to be basically most of the creep wave coming down right now to Koifa. So he's able to find this experience on the top lane. And now another stun being thrown out. Oh, Koifa, he win the tree line. They need TP support up here right now. The bear gets pulled in. The stun will go out in Koifa. And now M will clean up the tree line. He throws out the stun. Koifa still alive. That bear, he's got a body block out with the bear backed into a corner. Alchemist will take it. But Latrak, he's down here without a TP scroll. He could die to a creep wave. If there's a TP up on Lone Druid, now he can go. He's not going to get any last hit. With the creep wave that's there, and can just walk back past the tower. And no concoction being channeled up here by BZZ. He's had enough fun on that top lane for now. In the meantime, too, Luna on the bottom lane. At least 20-for-13. With that creep wave pushing in range of the tower, and they were searching for the kill. BZZ didn't really have as much time to farm up. And the funny thing is, like, when that happens, it's actually worse for him. He gets less gold from killing somebody than he does from finding than from actually farming. Because, you know, you get bonus gold from one kill. Yeah, that's great. That's fantastic. But he wants more money to come from actually killing off creeps. A creep rate with the bonus gold is probably about the same as killing off a hero for him. But even with a level 2 creeple screen, getting up a little bit higher, that'll probably be a bit better. Actually, no, that's only getting, he's only triggering like a 6 then. Missing a lot of hits underneath the tower. That's not great for him. In fact, missing off all bar one. I guess I'm watching people. They can't last hit when I do it. It's like Solus having a little bit of fun here with Fader in the middle lane. Fader has no mana, but you don't... Ooh, nice puck ulti. Solus is going to have to take the stun from this one. No orb, though. I thought Fader might have given that one a shot. I think he still realized the solo. Once that bottle charge went off, we would have had enough mana for an RP. And Fader may not have checked that. Like, we can see that ourselves, because we have the time to check this kind of stuff. But Fader's trying to focus on last hitting, throwing ulties, getting combos off correctly. You're not going to 100% check the mana pool of a hero every single time. Radiant structures are
fortified.
Koi, that's trying to pull the aggro down. He knows if he gets too close, though. Okay, there's an attack on the hero, and that pulls the aggro down. His new crew was coming in. It's probably the only reason, too, why he had that much confidence to come in close. Still missing a couple last hits onto the tower. Fader, as aggressive as he possibly can up against Solo. Doing so he can try and control the 6-minute room, but that's on the bottom lane. Ruby gonna take it, trying to actually latch Syndra up onto that cliff this time around, but didn't get the pull far enough, so Syndra just bounces back off the edge. BZZ going to play around that top lane still. Not getting as many last hits out there, really. He's missing a lot underneath that tower. There's a pull over to the side here, which has been nicely done by Koi. He's been a real pain in the ass. Found 5 levels from that top lane. Clockwise also found the same. And he's having to split it as well with a Rubik, who keeps just setting up for the pull. So even with this, they need Magnus to have Empower before they can say Alchemist come down here and farm this up. Because they need cleave damage to get through that. What have we got building up from Alchemist? So it's going to be a hand of minus for him. He wants extra levels. He's got a nice little stack over from the side here. Well, that wasn't intentional. He didn't grab one of the big ones, I don't think. Trolls? Yeah, actually, no. He must have grabbed one of the big trolls. Because he wants experience. He doesn't want money. He wants his level 16. Solo, now top lane. This is the death of Koifa. He can do nothing about it. Koifa, ulti time. He's got to get himself in there. Connects himself around. Whoa, Solo. Park, ulti, and the bear got an entangle. It couldn't have gone worse just then. And Lashrak, he was taking up a lot of damage from that pull on the side. He's in no position to fight right now. The Shockwave will still harass down the puck, but Fader came as soon as he realized the mag was missing. And came at the perfect time. Just bada bing, bada boom, through the creep wave. Silence over on the side. Thought Solo's a little bit closer. Solo does have this RP. Skewer in 1 second. He can kill off Fader if he wants to go for it. He wants this Wilkin as well, but he can't have everything in life. Pass also a little bit further up. Problems if Solo goes in then. He would have the bigger problem of having no extra support. Like Alchemist just got to the top lane. Concoction coming up. There goes the stun. Lashrak wants to follow up, but now he's taking damage from the bear. He's forced to move back. So BZZ just harasses him out of the lane. And in comes the Skewer. RP. Solo wanted it. But now he's wasting time. Has to pick up a TP scroll and get back to that middle lane right now while Fader is just free farming up while he's gone. And while all this is going on, an Alchemist being forced back, not keeping up with the gold. Koifa, get that bear out of there. In fact, he should probably just send it back to base to heal or resummon. And he's going to resummon. Black is still free farming on that bottom lane. 58 to 31. It's not even just the farming. You look at the denials out in him. 31 denies. This is how well Black controls a lane. Even with Dread in it, if they go one-on-one, you can still have a huge level difference. That's probably about 2 levels worth of denies right there from Black, if not more. That's just going to be the frustration for an offlaner. Like, even if you're close, you're still getting, like, semi the experience. Cinderin finding a fake fan score. And then just pops off yourself. Nabi is soon ready to push out this bottom lane. Black will also see him not actually going for his standard build. He's going straight into a BKB. Only one ability on the RoXKIS lineup that will go through that, and that's the RP. Now, if that's thrown off and he pops off the BKB, he can turn and fight and kill off everybody. Because there's no other stun that will hold him there. Even if something is stolen from RoXKIS, the only thing they could possibly steal is the bear. The bear will have an entangle. But you also got the clockwork cogs that will bounce him around a little bit. So you got that as well. Entangle on BZZ, first hit. Gets to burn a little bit, but goes into his chemical rage. Also puts that on cooldown now. Solo's going to pop off the haste rune. No warning again from Mousesports to look for this one. But you see where Koifa goes. He goes into a bit more of a foreign part of the tree line. So Solo comes up, and he checks where Koifa was before. Koifa shows himself. Rand scores the neighborhood, but it's nighttime, so the vision's not that great. And the bear's already been recalled, now brought back up again. Pulls a little bit of the aggro of the creep wave, in fact got all the aggro from the creep wave, but it's not going to stop the T1 tower from going down. BZZ remains here and gets the last hit in.
Radiant's top tower has fallen.
Well, Fader will chill and check out that middle lane. He can't push it. He doesn't have the power for it. The bottom lane, however, with support from Keeper of the Light, they could take that bottom tier 1 tower. Black's already coming up with the catapult, but Cinderin's on the other side of the Radiant Jungle right now. In fact, he almost looks like he wants to go to the top lane, but there's two TPs, the bottom lane. Dread with an ultimate. Solo's already here with his ultimate. Dangerous position to be. Same with BZZ. Gonna throw this stun off. Goes on Fader. There's no extra stun. The bear, it can't get an entangle. For all the hits, if Quiet forgot one, it would have been a kill. But the TP out of Alchem is successful, and BZZ lives. Now with 1,200 gold on him. Couldn't even buy the next... He couldn't even buy his next part of his next item, which is meant to be the Shadow Blade for him. Wants to move around Interface. Wants to jump in, be initiating. Be the man on the front lines. Made it continuously. Still finding his farm. He performs so well all the time in that middle lane. Now he finally breaks his smoke. Cinderin comes in too. Sentry Wars to go down. Three heroes in that middle lane. Think, yeah, Cinderin's Observer Ward, it spots it out. And now they're going to deep ward the Observer Ward, the Radiant side. I think they want to give it up, though. They're probably thinking that someone's going to come in here. Someone's going to come in with a sentry. And they instantly will jump them. With an invis and just jump them. That's RoXKIS' wards. So Mousesports are an Observer Ward. So RoXKIS can deep ward it if they get close enough to it. But if someone does come in there with smoke, they'll know about it. The mouse boss will feel a lot more secure about that region at this point. But at the same time, having a ward up and giving vision onto the high ground, the mid, sometimes it's just not worth it. Sentry wards and observer wards already down, watching from mouse boss anyway. They're watching the bottom movement from RoXKIS, so even if RoXKIS want to move around the rear of it and make the most out of that, the deception of the ward, it wouldn't be enough. Fader has an issue. Hopefully it doesn't last for too long. And we get ourselves back into this game very, very quickly. Having issues is a horrible, horrible thing. Many people have them. Too many pauses. Too many pauses. I love how Solo's the man to troll about that one after what's been happening tonight. Such a hilarious man. Such a hilarious man. I would laugh right now, but I would just feel like it would be faked. So I can't laugh about it. I can't laugh about it. The only thing I laugh about is the fact that Fader has issues. Interesting fact about Fader too, he's a resident of Berlin. So if you're a German tuning in, and you're like, yeah, I want to live in the same city as Fader. Then you gotta live in Berlin, peoples. You gotta live in Berlin. I actually didn't know that. I knew he was German. I knew he was German, lived around here somewhere. But didn't realize until we both found ourselves on exactly the same plane trip to the last EMS finals. I'm like, hey, is that? Yeah. Whoa, what's up, dude? What's happening? You're living in Berlin? You're flying out from Tegel Airport as well? Cool. So, yeah. There's definitely an easy way to pass the time when you're waiting for a flight to go to a DOTA land, and you just sit there with, one of the captains of the team, just talking about drafts. Best way to pass the time while waiting for a plane. It was a good moment. And poor Zoe sat there, hadn't slept much, and she just kept reading a book. According to her, it was a good book. According to me, drafting talk was a lot more entertaining. A lot more entertaining. Rule number 2, don't eat at PC. Need 5 minutes. What did he destroy? Source in the keyboard? That would make it difficult to control. That would make it very, very difficult to control. There's just water all of a sudden. Everywhere across the computer. That would be a new one. I kind of want to split up this VOD. I've already split up the other VOD. I don't want to split this one up. I want to keep it all in one big go. So people on the YouTube channel, put VOD starts here. It ends here. Thank you very much, Ryan, for keeping it clean. Keeping it clean. Source was enough of a word, man. Source was enough of the word. You didn't need any more than that. We're all good. We're all good for that one. Yeah. Anyway, what else do we got coming up that I could actually help people and know about? One thing, if you haven't seen it yet, definitely check out the Defense Courier. She's sexy. Absolutely sexy. So I say he is actually multiple couriers. So if you check out the website over at joinDOTA.com, you'll find this little guy or these little guys playing around. So if you have purchased a ticket of the defense, show it loud and proud in the games that you play. The ticket went out last night. Like I say last night, it went out like 2 a.m. in the morning here in Europe. Came with an extended patch. It was meant to come with the original patch, but I think there was some issue I was told about from Valve that it didn't go through at the right time. So I was like, okay, well, cool, fantastic. It's going to come out the next day. So yeah, if you have a defense ticket and you're watching inside the game, congratulations, people. If you're also watching on the live stream, thank you very much for your support. It's great having you here. Well, looks like we're actually good to go again. Remember, pick up the defense tickets. Show your couriers loud and proud, people. Show your couriers loud and all proud. Alright, back into the game. So 12 minutes in. Let's rock and rumble. RoXKIS still with three heroes in the middle lane. Fader. Doesn't really want to fight this one just yet. And they deward it straight away. Missing uphill. There's a pain in the ass. In fact, if you remain here any longer, it could be troublesome. Sindarin could have let off a covering blast then, but he decided to hold his mana. He only just popped Chakra anyway, so he's running lower mana as it is. He wants to make sure he can keep giving that over to Fader. Black. That's adding some pressure to that bottom lane. And they will be able to take out this, Well, if they had support, they could take out this tier 1 tower. But there's just no support. My brain just skipped logic there for a second. Sorry, guys. But we are 13 minutes in. Sindarin keeps the mana flying. Vanskorn just wants to hold that mid-tier 1 tower. They're trying to get his level 6. So far behind level. So far behind the last hits. Look at these levels. He's two levels behind that, the SD. 13 minutes in and you have a level 3 Rubick about to pop level 4. Yeah, you've got to find him some levels. Blink Dagger almost done for Solo. Once he gets back to base, he still won't have enough money left to wait a little bit longer. And also won't be able to buy a TP scroll for himself. So I'll have to buy it. Someone else will have to buy it. Latrak's still got the cash for it, but he's also very, very close to having his urn up and running. Fader now with an invis rune, so this is going to be that pressure on the bottom lane. Mag does buy up the Blink Dagger, and yeah, someone else bought him a TP scroll so he can get himself down that bottom lane. TP's into the tier 2 tower. Dread going to look for the lion to hook himself in. You can see the range of that ultimate coming down right now. That's that yellow lion that's on the map. On your screen, at home, where you're watching. And if you're watching Dota TV not following my perspective, then, yeah, you won't see that line at all. How's the Archivist looking? Picks up the Shadow Amulet first. Got himself another 400 gold before he's going to get there. Have we got the Empower buff up yet? No, we don't. They need that Empower buff before BZZ can really clean off this Ancient Stack. Even with the Toxic Spray, you see how much damage he just took? He got one hit out of that. Has to pop a salve while he's in Chemical Rage. This is just not right. They went too early for this. Vanskorn's going to come into the middle lane trying to hold that bear out. Mousesports just apply the pressure once they realize that a couple of heroes are missing. And notice where they go. Solo. Disruption. Catcher. He can always skewer himself away if things get a little bit rough. Doesn't need a blink. But the blink surprise is now gone. The blink surprise is now completely gone. Shadowblade is now afforded by the Arcus, but he could have found this farm elsewhere. They can keep stacking up the Ancients, but Magnus, he needed at least a level 10 before that fight began. And now he'll get it. Now he'll get it. Throws out the Shockwave, level 10 is now up, he's got 1 point in power. Now the Arcus could come back and do it. Just the space of 1 minute. That's all that really was. BZZ, now going to gank up middle lane. Puck might be close to a blink dagger, but he's going to be very, very close to death. In fact, does go down. Rubick's attack gets the last hit. Red was even throwing at the rocket. They found any kind of burst damage they possibly could. Quover's on the bottom lane and brings up his bear. Fires up the bears, and all of a sudden, T1 Tower will go down the bottom lane. There's a little bit of glaive coming off there from the Lunar already. 2 points up in him. Actually going for the second point in glaive so we can push a little bit faster and farm a little bit faster, as opposed to going for the fourth point up in the Lunar Blessing. So there's not as much damage on this bottom lane as there could be, and there won't be for a while too. Next level up is going to be his ultimate. Alchemist looking for the stun. He's going to stun himself, and that Shadow Blade is still going to have enough time for when he comes out. Like, actually, no, it's not. Yeah, it does. It took a little bit more time. And the bear hit around the tree line, so it wasn't spotted off instantly. Puck seems to be getting further away from that Blink Dagger. 600 gold when he wrote that, but now we're looking under 400 for him. Like almost half of that 300, in fact. And some damage to the Tier 1 tower. And Drew is back up on the top lane. Remember, they can keep doing this. Keeper of the Light, Blast, holds the Creep Wave out as well as Solo. Shadow Poison also helping out with that one. And all Syndrome's got to do is just pop the ultimate and bring him in. Might just get bought up on the Courier. Full Armlet for the Lone Druid. And a Buckler comes the way of Syndrome. But the Armlet going up to Lone Druid is the priority here. And what is quite fair? He actually ends up just popping a couple of things to sell so he can pick up a TP Scroll. Doesn't really need it though, because he's got this wonderful thing called a Keeper of the Light. But mine's just in case. TP Scroll, Boy Scouts thing, you gotta have him. And BZZ, he's actually abandoned his own jungle. He wants to gank up the middle lane, so he's just here and he's just farming up whatever he possibly can while he's here. So Chemical Rage, Shadow Blade, gonna look for the stun. Fade up. Ah, go, no, he's phase shifted a little bit. And BZZ, he's in range of the town. Fader can drop the ulti for this one. Perfectly visible in range of the tower. Shadowblade will not hide you from that one. Save the time for the orb. There's the damage. And one more right click. Lone Druid's attack will get it. Even got an entangle in the last hit from that. And now with the Alchemist down for RoXKIS, Mousesports will just advance themselves into the tier 1 tower in the mid. The big tank is gone for RoXKIS. Magdo, Blink, RP, 3 to catch, buyback will be there, the Cogs will then chaining off from Dread Black, he pops his own BKB as well as the ultimate, the Creep Wave still there, keeping Light Blast, helps up a Black, gets a double kill out of all that, even without Lifesteal, he still managed to stay alive in that, the town went down, BZ's looking for him, but there's a Sentry Ward, Lucid Beam, he's going to go down again, Solo blinks in to get the kill, but then entangled, RoXKIS, not only will they lose their entire team, but that the Alchemist buyback, and die again to kill off the Lunar, who also got a double kill. I think that bear got an entangle every single time it needed it. Come off cooldown, entangle again, and this will be the tier 2 tower to take a fall. The orb will fly. And the silence as well, there goes the tier 1, tier 2. Vanskor attempts the denial. Insanely costly fight for RoXKIS. And you see the drastic change in the gold and the experience graph. Almost a vertical line coming up. Now 7,000, almost 500 as well. Experience advantage going the way of Mousesports. And it's about 6.5 to 7k going the way of gold. About to become more. Fader comes in with an illusion rune. Nice denial there from Lashrak. The stand-in's in the right position at the right time. But there's still three towers lost within the space of a minute. After losing a team fight as well. For a team that hadn't lost a single tower to this point. And Mousesports have lost their tier 1 tower on the top lane. And that's all. TP now bottom lane, pass comes in. Could be a 5-man group up if Syndrome pops his ultimate and is bringing the lone druid. To this point, Koip is a little bit more concerned because he doesn't know where everyone is. Dread's in the middle lane. You can see Solo and Lashrak on the bottom lane. But that means Vanskor as well as BZZ is missing him. Shadowblade initiations. He doesn't feel enough confidence just yet. Even sitting in that ultimate form. There goes the TP out already. He's going back to base for this one. Doesn't have a lot of mana himself. Syndrome's going to pull him back out again though. He's a long way away. And there's the bear. I just spotted BZZ on the top. That might almost be a signal to push in. But at the same time, Clockwork Dread. That's a long latch and he pushes Fader back. It becomes rune control at the end of the day. Not an initiation kill. The Fader, he can throw an orb, push out this lane, and then everyone comes bottom. Syndrome with this blast. I don't know if he's actually going to get enough last hits out from this one. He's trying to get the mech up and running. Doesn't help it when Pass throws out that poison. Takes a lot of the farm from him. Coinfer goes back into his farming. Building a basher next on the bear. He's a recipe away while he's walking around with a Battle Giant strength on him. He's going standard boots on his bear this time around. So yeah, here comes the pull-ins. Cinderim. Puck comes in first. Now it's Coinfer. Where is the puck? In through the side. Already killing up. Vanscore over on the side. Throws the oldie. Rubik is dead. Fader almost dying to the Ancients. But now they realize it's that nice rocket from Clockwork. At the same time, Esty also dying off on the side. RP being used. Not yet. Now, no, doesn't even need it. Throws a shockwave. 3 euros from Mousesports lost. They might realize the stack and they throw down the extra observer ward there. So Mousesports will know when that camp is farmed. But to this point, Alchemist getting closer and closer now towards a BKB. Wants to pick up a TB scroll just in case. But they also want this tier 1 tower bottom lane. How many points? Edict, 3 points. RoXKIS, they get their revenge fight. They will take this bottom lane out. It shouldn't take them much time to do. Chemical Rage already been used for it. Luna is moving away down here. Very visible there around the Dire Observer Ward. Blind doesn't want to overcommit himself too far. There's that Yasha up on him. Can look towards the Mana style. Alchemist just stun himself again. Yeah, he's going to. Right in front of the Radiant Ward as well. In the meantime, Coinfer just keeps farming up on that top lane. I don't know if he's actually afforded his Basher just yet. Yeah, there's the recipe up on the Courier. And he just opens up on the Tier 1 tower. Fortification will have to be used by RoXKIS. Yep, there it goes. With that fortification down, yeah, because they're doing their Ancient stack. You've seen that in power, but look at Solo, he can't survive this. BZZ, he might even die right now. There's enough damage, in comes Luna. What a time to come in, Lucent Beam. It slows down Solo, Lashrak's done, buy some space. Puck will throw the orb and possibly the orb, and there's a blink from the mag to get to the tree line. The stand-in will take a fall for it. Black throws another Lucent Beam out in Dread. They didn't finish the entire stack. Now's that Observer Ward really kicking in. And the bear, well, just goes around the cogs. Pushes the creep wave up, and Dread can take the aggro from that one, but Coinfer, he's sitting over on the side, he can't actually push the bear to the left-hand side of the tower, because he'd be too far away. He's going to pull that bear back to attack on Dread. Where's the entangle? There it is, even with a four-star. A little bit too far away, the bear's causing too many issues, keeping the light blast. He also causing the issues, BZZ, BKB up, the pass, he let up the disruption, now the purge, BZZ, he can't get close up to kill off anybody. Black gets a full ulti off, Vanscore almost going down from it. Black just wants the last Lucent Beam, he's got the vision because another ward off from the side. Double kill, in fact, goes the way of Fader. The orb, sorry, was the one that gave him the vision. That wall was still too far away. But the tier 2 tower goes down. 3 euros in the sidelines. This is a big opening right now for Mousesports. Bear is still up. Black's still looking good, even without the BKB and the ulti down. Concoction will fly, but evaded. It's probably the only thing on this map right now. As Ryan said, it cannot be disjointed, that concoction. But it can be evaded. Dread 4-star. Gets the cogs. Gonna get orbed. Bear, entangle. He got it. He got it. Black being pushed back up again by the cogs. He's too far in. Disruption will buy him some more space, but the pulse, the damage, the clockwork latches in. They get the kill. Ruby takes his life. BZZ, he stuns himself up. He couldn't keep chasing. Solo's got an RP. Can skewer as well. Skewer to shockwave. May even be enough here. There goes your purge. And Solo says, well, you want to throw your ulti? I'll throw mine. Clockwork again stealing the kill with a rocket. But that's 12-10. And now Mousesports, they're the ones who slightly overextend themselves. And RoXKIS, they try and take the advantage of it. Straight in for Roshan. Negative armor, negative 3 because of that toxic spray at level 4. Lestrakstrun holds him there. Edict damage as well. You gotta eat through him as quickly as possible. Rocket's being thrown to keep the vision up. That's over the runes, in fact. And this is now Agassi Maul to go the way of BZZ. Now this is for his Basher. Well, just so he knows he can live. TP's top lane. Bear could even look to initiate on this one, but there's not enough people around here. Bear's going to be recalled back out. There's already the 4-star down. Clockwork tries a blind latch. It's a good position for it too. That was a normal TP spot out. The Fader went a little bit deeper before he TP'd out, and Coinfer just kept running. Dire's top tower has been denied. In the meantime, Tier 2 tower does go down the top lane because it's denied off by BZZ. That's all the outer towers now for RoXKIS gone. Every single outer tower is gone, and they've taken 2 tier 1s. Black is feeling the safest on the map right now. He can farm so much. And this is him farming up and only being 400 gold away from the net worth of the Alchemist. This shows you. In fact, if I bring up the CS board right now, yeah, the CS most definitely shows you. Through the CS as well as the towers, though. And that shows you also, there's a lot of showing right now, how powerful the Alchemist is. That is like 200 to 400 gold difference with the Alchemist. When he is behind by four towers, as well as that much CS, and he's still in front on the net worth. That's a dangerous thing just to see right there. And Solo, he doesn't care about that much about money. A Blink Dagger, getting a BKB would be great for him, but a Blink Dagger into a good RP is all he requires. Levels is more important for him, actually. More powers up in the more levels up in the Empower. That's so BZZ has more strength during the fights, too. And he is going to go into a Basher. With this creep wave coming up, he'll have a Basher. Which means now there's lockdown the Luna. Manda Style is not going to make it easy for him, but at the same time, the Manda Style is going to get cleaned off because of the Empower. The cleave damage which comes off from the Alchemist. Once that RP lands, the Manda Style, if there were illusions, they'll be gone almost instantly. Now, I think Mousesports realizes they are still taking some sweet-ass time to get themselves inside the base. That's why Mousesports wanted to force it before. They realize the clock is ticking on them. Even with a lone druid who has Basher and building in with AC, has a high percent up in the bear already. Like, he's looking really, really good, but Alchemist is still looking better. With the BKB and an RP, Mousesports can lose their entire team straight away. They need lane control. And that comes through Rax. They can break it. The only issue is they need Negus the Immortal really to do it. Get Negus the Immortal up on it'd be at Lone Druid or just Luna. Luna will be the main one. They'll probably want to keep alive the longest. She's the one that can go also down the fastest. But Alchemist at this point possesses the Aegis. There's a lot of heroes grouping up on the top lane. Sentry Ward's only for the Radiant side, so they don't really see deeper in here. Now they do see it because they do have a slightly aggressive ward in the jungle. Not the full-on aggression. It's more like that. Let's see when they move in and out of their jungle space. What a dread find. Aye. He found the wards. At least I'm assuming that's what's going on. Bear being played around with. Either that or Syndrome was farming something else up and threw a rocket out and hit him. That would be the other bingo. I doubt he found a ward. Smoke time. RoXKIS. Empower buff us, but of course it's only, they're all invis, so it's fine. They didn't show themselves to the creep wave just there. No sentry wards or observer wards watching this transition into the Radiant Jungle. So Mousesports been trying to control the Dire Jungle. They're not worried about the Radiant Jungle and Black. He couldn't be in a better position right now. Fader is in fact running all the way up that bottom lane. They're rotating middle lane. They'll kill off pass. A five-man initiation, or will they? Bears picked up. Oh, it spoiled everything. Koifa spoils everything. Fader continues to push out that bottom lane, realizing they're just so far away. Lets off the rift, blinks away, and now will TP out. While Cinderin kept adding a lot of pressure towards the top lane, has his mech. He'll also TP back the middle lane. Smoke goes on cooldown. They were trying to do something with this Aegis the Immortal. They've only got another minute and maybe 10, 15 seconds left on this thing. And they could not find an opening. And that's missed time as well for Alchemist Farm. He is not finding CS in the middle of this. And Black, in the meantime, he is. He still can't keep up with the net worth. But still, that's the price you pay going up against an Alchemist. BZZ using concoction now to stun up nothing but illusion pushes. Because Mana Star can easily do that. 3.3k up in the Luna. So we assume Butterfly for her. Probably the only real way you can try and evade that Abyssal Blade that'll be coming off from the Alchemist. And at the same time, does he try and go something else? Having the mana style is enough. He's got 3.6k gold that he can spend on anything he wants to. Maybe even just look to survive. But really, he kind of needs to look to do DPS. With the Assault Cuirass to buff him up, this is going to be all everything they need. Cinderin, not popping an ulti, and also Lone Druid. Having a TP scroll so he can come back. There's no issue with that. But he realized with the amount of pressure which is being applied through the bottom lane, why not just push out the top? Reason being, Observer Ward, perfect place. Sees Dreg coming up, and we'll know he's going to be looking for a hawk quite far in the tree line. He's using his bear to body block it out. Really smart play. Bear gets recalled. Dreg thought he was in. He thought he was going to TP in this spot. That was the line for the hawk. He went a little bit right, and then the bear was in a perfect position for a block. And it was a perfect position because he had the vision from the ward. So even a hawk wouldn't have stopped him from getting out of that one. Would have held his bear there just a little bit longer, but that's all. Cinder and Black team up again on the bottom lane. 4.4k gold now up on the Luna. Still also no lifesteal. Scythe device is what gets purchased up by the Puck. And then he also has a regeneration rune, so who cares about his low life points? Throw an orb out, have a bit of a scout if he wants to up to that high ground. Still no gem? Yeah, still no gem. Even with all the warning that RoXKIS is doing, there's still no gem out in the field just yet. And Luna will go butterfly. So we're going to see the standard black. Nothing unusual. Cinderin, get out of there. That Keeper of the Light Blast. Just waiting for the mag to blink. Just jump over the blast. Skewer him back in again. Cinderin goes down the long lane. Gonna happen very, very easily. But Solo doesn't want to risk anything. He doesn't know what support's behind Cinderin. And they have no vision around the Ancients area of their own. Or even down into the Radiant Jungle. So he can't just jump it. He's got to be more cautious about this, especially when he just picked up his BKB. He needed that money in the bottom lane to get it. Rock it on. Vader, in the meantime, has got all the confidence in the world. Blink Dagger and a Scythe of Vice. In fact, if there's anything bar a support hero that comes up to this top lane, they'll take care of him. Oh! I mean, anything bar a carry hero, he'll instantly kill off the supports. That's why Vance call. In fact, they send two supports. Smooth! Dread. He knows he can just four-staff himself away if things get a little bit too rough. See BZZ with his next item. So he's just happy with having the bash effect. Doesn't need the full Abyssal Blade and goes into an AC. He also knows he needs to offset what's happening right now on the Spirit Bear. This is something he must do. With the AC aura dropping him down, you know he's going to die off very, very quickly. He's only got 5 armor as it is. And then you want to add an AC effect onto that one? Welcome to nothing. We're talking about the problems with Doom last night when he only had 0 armor. The funny thing is, too, Alchemist, he just finished his AC. Courier picks up the Hyperstone, gets it back in very, very quickly. This is the speed an Alchemist can farm. The creep waves keep coming in, he just keeps taking more and more farm. The Alchemist, to a point, can almost tank up all of Mousesports. The problem he has is the bear. Lone Druid's bear is going to completely lock him down. And then when that happens, Luna has space. And we'll just right-click through the Alchemist. And every time he attacks the Alchemist, he's killing off Lashrak and killing off Rubick. Every time it'll happen. Because the bouncing glaives just destroy all. You always see it when you push into a base with Luna. I don't think Mousesports have the same Ryan-y effect that my stream has. They don't know when Roshan's gonna spawn. But you got Luna. It now is, man. It now is. We create words. And Roshan is up now. RoXKIS are in perfect position for it. BZZ. He may even give it a shot right now. Chemical Rage and go. Or as long as he can without Chemical Rage. There's the Empower buff up. So no, into Chemical Rage. They got this. Mousesports were right next to it. The support being brought in. The Keeper of the Line Blast is not going to make this easy, but it's already been done. The Blast will fly, and Roshan is killed by the Dire Side. Thought we were going to see a bit of a snipe off with that Blast, but didn't happen. An Alchemist will take the Aegis Immortal. This is RoXKIS' big, big lifeline. When BZZ farms up this bottom lane as well, with a new creep wave coming in, getting all these last hits in here, that should be... It's close if they stop taking the last hits from him. That could have been very, very close to Abyssal Blade. With all the bonus gold he can get. 6 seconds till Chemical Rage. Vision for the Dinosaur on the high ground. Radiant side of Ord now expires in the middle lane. And they just send Alchemist in. They don't care. Let him finish up this creep wave. Get back in there, man. You got farm to have. Now, they should really stop taking farm from him and let him finish his Abyssal. Magnus might have been looking for enough money for a buyback. He's on the edge of it right now. If he dies, he'll lose too much money. He can buy back at the moment. Well, there you go. Now the calculation is, in fact, there. He needs another 410 gold before he's capable of buying back. But once he pops the RP, he's done his job. So buyback isn't important for him. And now BZZ's got the choice. Does he go straight into the Abyssal Blade? Does he try something new? He's got an Aegis Immortal in his inventory right now. He's got no other slots apart from an Abyssal Blade. That's basically his choice. Until the Aegis is gone, he has no other choice. And once the Aegis is gone, then he can pick up his heart. But he'll walk up and he'll find a fake SD. Doesn't buy the Abyssal though. He keeps his money for buyback. He is actually worth it having a buyback. But he's got an Aegis Immortal on him. So maybe just a little bit, being a little bit more like safe and secure. And that's what he's going to do. So we're going to go into a Monkey King bar. Okay, well obviously the bash chances won't happen at the same time, but that's increased your chance for a perma bash. But he doesn't have a huge amount of attack speed with this. The Hyper Stone helps him out. But his attack speed isn't amazing. Alright, so there we go. Monkey King bar will be purchased and he sells his Shadow Blade. He's going to fight like a man. And still has a decent amount of money. Enough money for a buyback, in fact. Even should be even after death. He's close. He's 150 away from it. But more than likely, him going down, he'll find himself a kill and get that 150 gold. There's no real problem with that whatsoever. Fader back up to the top lane now. Look to push it out. Or push it in, I should say. He's already with 3k gold of his own. Looking to assault that tier 3 tower. Or at least force RoXKIS back. But RoXKIS, they're going all in for this one. Disruption goes off. Aegis Immortal still got some decent time on it. BZZ just keeps beating it down. Lashrak's done stunned up both the SD illusions. And that AC aura can be returned by those illusions too. And then the bear comes in, so the real aura arrives. Fader throws, what a wonderful ulti. Three to be caught. Solo, he's going to save his teammates right now. Ends on the way out. Vanskor goes down. He gets bashed up by the bear. But Solo's BKB goes on cooldown. Lunar actually killed off the Lashrak as well, my bad. But 14 for 10, two heroes and sidelines, both the supports. Buybacks won't be available for either of them. So the Cogs have to defend from Dread. And the call is actually from Mousesports to go in through the bottom. The top lane's pushing in already. So they know that RoXKIS will have to move up to the top lane at some point maybe to defend that. So they push in through the bottom. The side lanes are always the better ones to take as well. Oh, silence on Dread. He's still got the Cogs off. Very, very lucky to do so. Now your RP. He only got Black. The disruption means they cannot stun up on Black. So he comes back out again. There goes your Eclipse and your Keeper Light Blast. Entangle up on BZZ. Aegis Immortal will pop. Dread away. Is he far enough? Fader wants to finish the job. Blinks up. He takes him. The respawn is now up to BZZ. Bashed up and held. No Chemical Rage and GG. Well played. In 39 minutes, Mousesports will break through the bottom. And they force out a GG from RoXKIS. That'll be all she wrote. Pastille wants to play around a little bit with the Magnus. Sliding in. Sliding in on it. And BZZ, he's going to find revenge on Cinder in here. Just a little bit of it. But Black, there is just way too much damage from him. Bounce, she's starting to attack on the tower so he can find the glaive bounce off from that one. But BZZ, so okay. Hatred on supports. And supports fight back with disruption. And Black... able to make the most out of that one. So that's GG. The admin can give the command and make it also 18 for 11. So Mouse, yes, they also won a game. Yes, they, yes, they won a game. That's obvious. I don't know what you're on, Ryan. I don't know what you're on. It's Mousesports taking this 2-0. It's Mousesports taking this 2-0, unless I'm saying something weird. Man, you don't know what I'm on. But this is going to be a full GG. Come on, admin, give the command. Quaver, wow, don't hate the Bears, but the Bears be hating on this on the stand-ins. Skewer Rune actually helps to get the kill. But that's going to be it. That's going to be all she wrote. So thanks for watching tonight, guys. That's going to be the end of the Mousesports versus RoXKIS matchup. Their last game of the night was postponed, so keep your eyes over on the-defense.com to work out when the next game will be. Of course, that one's easy. That one's really, really easy. When the postponed game will be, that one's a little bit more difficult. But the next game will be tomorrow at 16 CEST. Absolute Legends will be playing up against Next.KZ. Absolute Legends looking to see if they can break their losing spree right now. They are 0-4 in their group stage matchup that will be playing tomorrow. So we have a Group B matchup, and then we go through three Group A matches. Na'Vi will play two of their remaining three games tomorrow up against both Kieta as well as Team Empire, and then those two teams will face up against each other to cap off the night. So Kieta and Team Empire, still a lot of games. Well, actually, Kieta will play out all their games tomorrow. Team Empire will still have one more game remaining after tomorrow's matchup. But of course, as always, check the details over on the-defense.com. If you miss any of the games from today, youtube.com/joindota, or you can just check the VOD library over on joindota.com. Luckily, with the way the defense is run, it's actually impossible to have spoilers on this because there is always two matches with the matchups. But you can also subscribe to the YouTube channel, check it out there, watch the Twitch channel, and do all that kind of jazz. Anyway, guys, rebroadcast coming up soon. If you missed any of the games from today as well, they're all going to be rebroadcast in a couple of moments' time. So thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you all tomorrow at 16 CEST.
I said good day, sir!